Mukhanov, which we did, you know, over a few years. Let me see. Does it? Okay. So, you know, there is a long history about this, how to unify gravity with gauge interactions. And the history started with Einstein, and soon after he did his general relativity, he worked on, you know, he got correspondence from Kaluza, I think, at the time. And it was this five-dimensional space. And so they put a constraint on the metric on five dimensions to get electromagnetism. I think he was very excited about it. But after a year or so, the excitement died. And then he was convinced that it's not the right way to get electromagnetism. And now we know it's not, actually. So, of course, you know, you have the problem of all the other modes. But at the time, you know, they constrained the theory. So it was no other modes in the original model. Then, actually, he really worked for, I think, like 10 years or something on something called Hermitian gravity. And for this Hermitian gravity, the metric has a symmetric piece and an antisymmetric piece, which he called B. And he was hoping that the B is the electromagnetic tensor F mu nu. It's the field strength. And then he put some metricity condition where gamma is Hermitian. And, you know, it took, you know, I think until he died, he was working on this problem. In the end, I think he almost gave up. But he said that it seemed that he needs new kind of geometry. However, if Riemannian geometry is the right approach, then he is on the right track. So, anyway, so essentially this was, now it's called actually the model is called the Einstein-Strauss theory. I think Strauss joined him, I think, 1945 or something, and they wrote papers. And a very difficult system to solve, actually, this system.
They take the
Einstein-Hilbert action. Actually, there are really two possibilities for the Einstein-Hilbert action, because there are two contractions for the curvature tensor now. But the other one is not relevant. And he had some ambiguities, actually, how to construct the Riemann tensor. And he had to add a Hermitian conjugate to the tensor. Actually, he didn't know that the Riemann tensor he constructed was really already Hermitian, but it was not easy for him to see because the proof in that language is not easy to see. Okay. However, you know, I will talk about how can one make these things in an easy way. Now, we know, actually, that non-commutative geometry unifies gravity, gauge, and Higgs fields by tensoring a discrete space with a four-dimensional continuous manifold. However, even in non-commutative geometry, there is a distinction between the gauge fields and the spin connection. So when you write D, you see that you start with a D, which is for space-time, where spin connection is there, and you add to it another piece, which is for the gauge piece. It's the sum of two pieces. Yeah, so the two groups, as we know, the spin connection has a group, and it's, you know, the group SO13, which is the Lorentz group. And however, for the gauge, is a different group. And these things are, you know, it's a semi-direct product. It's not really a full combined symmetry. So there's this point. Now, of course, actually, we can couple. See, the Dirac operator, of course, is only important if you want to couple to spinners. Bosons don't care about Dirac operators. They only, you know, they don't feel the Dirac operator. They feel Laplacians usually. Right? It's never there. Now, if you look at the Dirac action in flat space, in Minkowski space, that's actually the way that Dirac originally constructed it. And you see that actually that the gamma matrices define a Clifford algebra with the eta matrix, which is a Lorentz metric. And one has to take actually define the Hermitian conjugate. One has to put the gamma zero. You know, I'll talk about, you know, my talk is essentially in Lorentz space, but, or Minkowski space, but I can go immediately to Euclidean. And all these signatures will disappear. Of course, instead of psi bar, you have to put psi dagger. I think this is the main thing, but Fedeli already discussed this thing. And now the important thing, actually, that as I said, where's the pointer button, you know? Here? Here? Oh, the red one. Okay, yeah, thank you. Red one, okay. Does it see? Do you see something?
Yes.
But I don't see it. You know. Ah, yeah, no. You know, if you see it, I don't see it, you know. It's not good, you know. Okay, so you see, actually, this is the crux of the matter. Psi goes to this transformation. But notice, actually, that these gamma matrices are what we call flat gamma. They are numbers. It's not that it would feel the gamma mu in this case. The Dirac operator, of course, gamma mu. And for this, you need the Fehrbein. Now, so in Kerr space, what you do, you know, you need actually your action to be invariant under general Gordon transformation. So you say, okay, d mu, there are two things that you have to do. D mu would go to d mu plus, you know, spin connection. And this is the generators of the Lorentz algebra. And this is the d mu. And then the action psi d psi. And of course, you have to put E, which is determinant of E mu A. And then this action is invariant both under general Gordon transformation and local Lorentz transformation. It's both. And both are important for the Dirac operator. Okay? Now, the spin connection here actually is not an independent field. The spin connection is, you know, the best way to define the spin connection is to go to the Cartan formulation. And in the Cartan formulation, you define the torsion, which we assume is zero. Zero torsion spaces is DEA plus omega ABEB is a two form. And the component is, you know, this is a torsion tensor. But in this formulation, actually, these are the frames. And this is flat, but these are curved indices. And you do assume that the TA is zero. And because this is antisymmetric, you get a condition, which is d mu in u a minus d nu plus omega minus omega, because the form, you get actually symmetry. You have to anti-symmetrize everything. And then you start counting, you know. You say, how many equations I have in four dimensions? As you see, because mu nu is antisymmetric, these are six components, and a is four, so you get 24 equations. And how many variables we have? We have the spin connection omega mu a b, which is because it's the Lorentz algebra is antisymmetric. So, of course, AB is anti-symmetric. You get 6 times 4 is 24. The number of equations match the number of conditions. You can solve for omega mu AB, and you say, okay, we determine it completely. So, in the previous page, you see this omega is really a function of E. So, it's not an independent field. You know, it's unlike Gauge-Yang-Mill theory, where the gauge fields are really independent functions. Here, the gauge fields in gravity are dependent functions. They depend on the Fehrbeins, all right? Now, of course, actually, the metric is formed out of the product of two E's. So E essentially is the square root of the G. So actually, that's why we always say that Dirac equation is obtained by taking square root. E is the square root of G. And in addition, because of general coordinate invariance, you have an affine connection, which is symmetric. So this is gamma. And this satisfies metricity condition. It means, you know, that the covariant derivative of the metric is equal to zero, which means that you can integrate by part using this covariant derivative. And again, actually, you see actually that the number of equations match the number of variables. Here, you have mu nu is symmetric, so we have 10. And this index rho is 4, so we have 40 equations. And the gamma, we assume actually that the gamma is symmetric connection, is a symmetric affine connection. So you see actually this has also 4 times 10, 40 conditions. And you can solve this equation to get really the Christoffel connection. So the Christoffel connection is obtained from the electricity condition. You have 40 equations with 40 unknowns. You solve it, it gives you the Christoffel connection. Now both conditions, this condition and the, you know, here I have 24, here I have 40. I can combine them in one condition. And this is the metricity condition on the Fehrbein, or the soldering form. And you see, actually, I have 4 times 4, no symmetry now. 4 times 4 times 4 is 64. And the number of variables, again, is 24 and 40. So you can use these 64 equations to solve uniquely for omega mu AB and the omega mu neuro. And exactly, you know, the solutions are exactly the solutions I told you about. It's a symmetric piece of this equation, and the anti-symmetric piece of this equation, the torsion equation, the symmetric piece of this equation, and you really can solve the system, okay? Now, obviously, you know, if you assume metricity condition on the Fehrbein, it ensures, actually, that this Dirac action, because we write psi d psi, but, you know, actually, to prove the hermeticity of the action, you have to integrate by parts. You know, psi d psi. Here, the d is on the psi dagger. Here, the d is the derivative on the psi. So in order to show that this is equal to this, you have to integrate by part. And if you integrate by part, you see, actually, that if you know that omega mu eb are dependent, if you use a metricity condition, this equation follows immediately. Actually, the metricity is a bit stronger than this, but it is sufficient to prove the metricity of the Dirac operator. So, Dirac operator is Hermitian, and the omega mu, because the E is satisfies the metricity condition. Now, obviously, here we really have a spin, we have a curvature, because this omega is like a gauge field of the SO group, of the Lorentz group. So, obviously, if you have any gauge field, you can form curvature. You know, the curvature in this language is always d omega plus omega squared. You know, you simply square the covariant derivative, essentially, and you get d omega plus omega squared, whose components are this curvature tensor. This curvature tensor is, I should say, r of mu of omega. It's the spin connection curvature tensor. But remember, actually, I have already, you know, in differential geometry, we define the Riemann tensor to be the, in function of the Christoffel connection. You see? Now, it's easy to see, using metricity condition, that d mu d nu acting on the Fehrbein gives me the curvature tensor of the spin connection. But it also gives the curvature tensor of the gamma. They are related to each other through this relation. The reason, the proof actually is one line. You look at the metricity condition. I go back. This is the metricity condition. It really has two pieces. One is a covariant derivative with respect to the Lorentz index. And it has another piece, which is with respect to the coordinate transformation. So, but this is zero. Therefore, this covariant derivative is a gamma. So I plug back. I plug back, and I use that this is a gamma. But when I take the commutator now, I start differentiating the gamma. So I get d gamma. And because I have dd, I get gamma squared. I get d gamma plus gamma squared, which is nothing but the curvature tensor. And therefore, this is a proof. And it means, actually, then I can further show that if I construct the Einstein-Hilbert, or the scalar curvature of r of omega, it's really identical to r of gamma. There is no distinction. Now, we really can understand this as follows. We look at this action. This action, of course, you know, depends on the spin connection, depends on, but is also, it has an invariance, which is Lorentz invariance, in addition. This doesn't see Lorentz. It doesn't see it at all. It's only a function of the metric. Now, we go back, actually, to the definition of g mu nu. You see, g is e mu a e nu b, so it doesn't really care about the Lorentz. But the e does care about the Lorentz transformation. The e transformed in the Lorentz transformation, and there are six parameters in the transformation. Therefore, and this is invariant. And therefore, I can use the Lorentz invariance to make e mu a, which has 16 components, the lambda AB, which is the Lorentz transformation, is anti-symmetric. So I can use the lambda AB to make E mu A completely symmetric. You know, so essentially, this shows that this metric is, sorry, this action is completely equivalent to this action because up to a sign in the determinant of E. So you have to fix the determinant of E is positive, right? Yeah. You have to say determinant of E is positive, right? All right, you see here. This is delta mu, lambda ab. They are 6 parameters. I can gauge a way to make a e mu a is symmetric. If I make it symmetric, then you see that you have only 10 independent components in the e, which matches the 10 components of the g mu. So it's actually, all of this is known. Now the question, can we make use of it, you know? First of all, as I said, the spinners transform like scalars under general coordinate transformation. They really transform under this, under Lorentz transformation, and is really governed by this Clifford algebra. So the most important thing here is really the starting point, the Clifford algebra for the spinners. Now, taking a hint from non-commutative geometry, where the number of components of the spinners. Here, actually, you say, okay, I have, you know, four component spinners. You can apply Weyl conditions if you wish, but they are really four component spinners. But in non-commutative geometry, actually, if you look at the Hilbert space, now we know the Hilbert space would have, it's a spinner, but on the other hand, it also fields the discrete space with its symmetry of the standard model or whatever. So it has more components actually there. So the number of components of spin is larger than four of the tangent bundle. So we suppose now actually I want to release the restriction that the number of dimensions of the tangent space match the number of dimensions of the manifold. See, Weinberg, I think 87 or something, he wrote a paper where he investigated, he removed this condition, but he looked for lower dimensions, not higher dimensions. Lower dimensions doesn't work because it's just too tight, you know. You cannot accommodate generativity in that. He found nothing interesting. Now, let's actually look at this matricity condition now again, but saying that this index A has a dimension which is n, you know. See, look, again, I'm doing everything Lorentzian, so I say starting from 0 to d minus 1. Here I start from 0 to n minus 1. So this is really d-dimensional and this is n-dimensional. So tangent space is n-dimensional and the manifold is d-dimensional, okay? I will, you know, I will specialize later to 4 dimensions and n is larger than 4. See what happens. But we can keep actually the discussion more general and see the consequences. Now let's look at these conditions. We count how many conditions I have. I have d times d times n. I have d squared n conditions. What are my variables now? They are a spin connection, which is belongs, you know, to start with, I take it to belong to SON. And this is a symmetric affine connection. So we really have a condition. I will have a matching if this condition is met. And we discover actually there are really two solutions for this equation. There is one solution which has been overlooked in the literature for, you know, so many years. And this is really when n is not d, n is equal to d. We saw it's already satisfied. But there is another solution, n is d plus 1. If you simply add one extra dimension, nothing happens. So n is d plus 1. And then actually I really can write this Dirac operator. You see? Where gamma A, gamma B is minus 2 eta AB. And of course, now it's tricky actually to define the inverse metric, but you can define it, you know, first you compose this metric G mu nu, and then you invert this metric, and then you can raise the index to define the opposite. And then you discover actually that E mu A, E nu B with the mu contracted is not delta AB. Yeah? You find that's delta AB minus eta A, NA, NB, where N is some normal vector. So you see you have introduced, you know, some vector which is perpendicular to the manifold, and some arbitrariness.
Is the interpretation a sort of intuition in mind that this is like a Lutzak line, where you think of the metric which is not dependent on this extra coordinate?
Yes. Well, actually, it's not, you know, it's not really going to be Kaluza-Klein line. We'll see actually that it will not be Kaluza-Klein. You know, okay, it's similar, but not exactly the same. There is a slight difference actually, which I will talk about.
But do you have some parameter which would be something like, you know, you assume that this metric in this extra thing is one, or you have some freedom in it?
No, it's free. It's completely free. It's completely free, yeah. This NA is completely free. But I will show actually that things will become independent of this NA, and we'll see what it is actually. So here, what do we do? We have this metric, mu A, mu B, mu, and you know, now I go back and I really reconstruct all my previous steps. As I said, there's a curvature in, for the spin connection, there is a curvature for gamma, and the proof goes through. It doesn't really know about whether N is D or N is D plus 1. Exactly the same proof. So generativity would allow, you know, the five-dimensional tangent space to give me an exactly the same answer as the four-dimensional case. No difference whatsoever. And then you can construct, you know, higher curvature terms, and it's there, everything is identical, completely. No difference whatsoever. So what is the difference, you know? How do we know that actually our tangent space is four-dimensional and not five-dimensional? Of course we know, because the spinners feel it, you see? The spinners feel the tangent group. It feels this. So when I write psi bar d psi, when I'm going to write this, I will see this gamma BC. It will see it. What are the consequences of this? The consequences, now, what is the signature of them? Eta AB, you know, I can choose a signature to be a minus with four pluses or two minuses with four pluses. And one would correspond to the Lorentz group SO14 or SO23. Now, remember actually, if we want to impose Weyl condition or Majorana condition on the spinners, they only know about this signature. It doesn't care about the signature of space-time. It only cares about this signature.
Mm-hmm. Not just when n is even, it's true when n is
even. For any n, yeah. No, it's true in general. This equation, you know, you can do it in any dimension you like, and there are always two possibilities. Always two possibilities.
So it's not related to this fact that the gamma matrices, you know, when you go from even up the
matrix. No. See, this is not, okay. See, okay, spinners would know. Let me say what the spinners will do. I said what the bosons will do. Bosons, vectors, scalars, you know, they don't care. You know, I give them this tangent of 4 or 5, it's completely equivalent. But spinners know the difference. And because if you would like to impose a Weyl condition or Majorana condition, for example, if you take this signature, you know, you discover that you cannot impose neither Weyl nor Majorana because the spinners think that they are living in five dimensions. And you know that in five dimensions with signature minus plus plus plus, you cannot impose the Weyl condition, you cannot impose Majorana condition. However, if you really take this signature, you can impose Majorana condition. So you see, actually, you really now can do everything that you did in particle physics, I would say, even standard model, using this signature, and the thing would not care, you know, would think that we are living, so my statement is that you can do, especially for supersymmetry, which loves the Majorana signature, because supersymmetry is defined with Majorana spinners, it would love actually to take this, okay? So you really can do all kind of physics with this metric, all right? So, you know, spinners are sensitive. However, actually, here, you know, in this case, you should refrain from lifting or decomposing, taking vectors in tangent space, because if you take, for this signature, vectors in tangent space, they are really going to get negative kinetic term. So you should only take vectors, which are tensors, and then spinners will be okay. All right. So now, actually, the interesting part will come. So what do we do? One possibility would be to allow emu A to be complex, the sphere bind to be complex, which is essentially what Einstein did when he said, I would like to consider Hermitian gravity. So what happened this condition? Well, with this condition, matricity condition, if E is complex and omega is really anti-Hermitian, because you would like to be anti-symmetric, so you'd say anti-Hermitian, and the omega to be Hermitian, the gamma, sorry, so you take the same matricity condition, and you discover, actually, that this thing does work in D dimension. So in D dimension, you can apply metricity condition. But now the group is not the Lorentz group. The group is the unitary group, U of D essentially. If you forget about signature, it is U of D. So you can allow actually unitary transformation, not only orthogonal transformation. So this would correspond to a group which is Hermitian. And the nice thing about it is that now you go and you construct actually all these actions that I wrote before, and you know the proof keeps working. This, but now actually you have to be careful about up indices and down indices because it's complex. So in order, you know, for example, this will have an index up and index down because unitary, but the proof still works. Now the nice thing about it is that, you know, you recover all the results of Einstein and Strauss in one page now. And all the, you know, you don't have to add the tensor, the curvature tensor. You don't have to add to it Hermitian conjugates because already Hermitian. You know, here you can see it in one line, but there it's not easy to see. You know, I looked at the papers, and in the way Einstein does it, it's not easy to see. So you really can recover what we call Hermitian gravity, and it really works pretty well. But again, actually, what would be the problem? So you get actually Hermitian gravity, but now, of course, spinners would know. If you look at the spinners, what do they do? The spinners will tell you, oh, I have the unitary groups now. So the spinners are going to feel the unitary group. And the spinners in this case would only accept Dirac spinners because you cannot impose any Weyl condition. The Weyl condition would not be consistent with the U symmetry. You know, the gamma and the U, because the U is defined in terms of the Clifford algebra. And, you know, you have two kinds of gamma matrices. So anyway, it would not accept any condition on it. And you can only do Dirac spinners.
The real structure
on what?
Sorry, the J, the square root.
You can.
So well, in this.
Yeah, of course you can. But then you have to have more than one. Yeah, so you can have two sides on which you apply a Majorana condition. So you double it, and you reduce, but still it's like two guys, okay? So you will not be able to do, you know, chiral fermions, for example. That's not possible, okay? Well, maybe possible, but, you know, as I'm going to talk, one can always find a solution to these problems if one works hard enough. Okay. Now, the question now is whether it is possible to have a sensible system where the number of constraints is less than the number of variables, you know, because I was always insisting that I put constraints, number of constraints should match the number of variables, you know, because I said I want a solvable system, you know. This was my ideology, and, you know, Slava told me, why are you always insist? You know, it's ideology, no? So anyway, so let's actually get rid of this ideology and say, okay, what happens if the numbers do not match? Okay? But of course I'm going to have less conditions than variables, because if I have more conditions than variables, the over-constrained system usually is inconsistent, and, you know, so we assume that now this index A is not D or D plus one. It's bigger than, larger than or equal to D plus one. Okay? We'll see what happens. This is the spin connection is anti-symmetric. This is the affine connection is symmetric. Then we have D squared and constraints. So I start now counting. I have D times N. I have D squared and constraints. For how many variables I have here? You see this mu index is D. And this is N into N minus 1 over 2. This is N minus N 1 over 2. So this is the number of the omega variables. And for this, I have D into D plus 1 over 2 from the down and the D in the up. So, you see, and this actually the numbers, and we require that this number is smaller than this number. And then we, anyway, I just make an assumption. And then I see, can I solve the system? So what do? I divide actually my index A into from, you know, 0 to D minus 1 to D dimensional and the remainder, okay? N minus D here, which I'm going to call I. So I have two set of equations. D mu in UA is the same equation, actually. I simply expand this equation, allowing A to be first little index A, but running on A and I. So I get actually here summation B, here summation on I, and here I get the remaining equation with the I, and then I look actually at my system. First of all, I would notice that the first set of equation, the first set of looks exactly like the matricity condition on D dimension. There's nothing but you have one extra term. But it's exactly the same matricity condition in D dimension. So which means actually, in principle, I can solve for omega mu AB and gamma mu nu rho. I can solve for it. And this is a constraint on the remaining. You know, I have omega mu IA. I would see that the number of equations here, which is the difference between this and that, as you see, you know, you can count. It is d into n minus d. And this would have the dimension into d into n minus d. Exactly the same. So essentially, this equation you can use to solve for omega mu IA. What's really remaining is the gauge connections in the n minus d variables. So here. So you can solve, actually, from the first equation for the usual d-dimensional spin connection. You can solve for the affine connection. And the second set would determine omega mu ia, but this leaves the variables omega mu ij undetermined. What are these variables, actually? They are nothing but the SO n minus d. They are the SO minus d gauge fields. They are completely unconstrained. You see? Now, looking at the Fehrbein transformation, which where lambda AB is antisymmetric, I discovered actually that I can choose these parameters, lambda IA, to gauge fix the E mu I to zero. Why? Here I have D into N minus D, and these are D minus N, D minus variables. Therefore, I can use all the freedom, the gauge freedom I have, to set E mu I to zero. If I set E mu I to zero, I go back to this equation. If E mu I is zero, this is zero, this is zero, it implies that omega mu IA is zero. And if omega mu IA is zero, then what happens is that this gauge symmetry, you know, by fixing a gauge, but I don't have to fix a gauge. SON, essentially, is broken into SOD into SON minus D, completely. Where the A mu IJ are completely, gauge fields in the SON minus D group. Now, what does this result mean, actually? Okay, I say, okay, let me write. The curvature of the spin connection. I have here R mu ij. And I start actually relating all curvature contractions for the spin connection and trying to express it in terms of the curvature connections in terms of the gamma. And we find that the first term is the same. So the Einstein term doesn't really care. It's exactly the same. So you can write Einstein term for the SON gauge theory, and you still get with a tangent, with a much larger tangent space, and you still get the same Einstein action. You cannot distinguish between them if you only have bosons, okay? However, here, this curvature square term, well, gives me again. And this one gives me again. But however, there is one contraction which gives the R squared, square of the R squared, the Riemann squared, plus the Yang-Mills squared. So this already knows, actually. So we find a place if, so actually, what I say, when n equal to d or n equal d plus 1, there's no distinction whatsoever. And we see, actually, why when d plus 1, there is no distinction, because this vanishes in one dimension higher, because this has to be antisymmetric. If you have one index, you cannot antisymmetrize it. You need two indices at least. Okay? Which means that Einstein could have succeeded if he did it in six dimensions, not in five, to get the Yang-Mills field, because you need SO2. So for SO6, you know, you get SO4 across SO2, so SO2 is a U1, so you can get electromagnetism. Okay? But of course, now you can get much higher because, you know, there is no constraint on what this group is. It could be any SO group. So it could be, it's really SON minus D. So this actually shows that in reality, this, there is a unification of the gauge and the gravity. And if I write actually the most general action in terms of the spin connection curvatures, of course I can add, you know, curvatures for the fine connection, but they simply change the coefficients. But this is the answer. And you really get, in the same way, the Young-Mills. So Young-Mills is not extra you add. You simply say, I have a larger tangent space, and I will get the Young-Mills answer. Now, let's look at the Dirac operator. Dirac operator, of course, now, is this full guy. And let's see what, you know, okay, what I'm telling you is that now this gamma A mu. Now, in the special gauge, this would split into two pieces because, as I said, I can always choose E mu I to be zero. If I choose E mu I to be zero, you see this part would split into two pieces. One will be the spin connection and the other is the gauge piece. So the Dirac operator that we write and we have been writing can be immediately promoted, to the SO N symmetry without losing anything at the expense of putting this other useless guy with IA mu to extending the tangent space to be larger. So you can always do that. And for, and in this case, what do you really get? You get, in addition to the Einstein action, you will get the Young-Mills action. Now, what happens, actually, if I say, look, I would like to do spectral action with this Dirac operator? What do I get, you know? You really get, sorry, keep losing this. Okay, so you get cosmological term. I already told you, actually, that when you do first contraction of the R is identical. When you do second contraction, one of the R mu nu rho sigma squared, one of it, will be Young-Mills. Yeah? So, you know, this 7 over 4 becomes 15 over 4 or something. It's really a fixed coefficient. And this is the answer. So if you do spectral action with this Dirac operator, you already unified, gravity and Young-Mills. Nothing else, you know. Okay? So the A4 term is still conformally invariant, still holds. But as I said, you get and no extra pieces.
Can you do this calculation for any dimension?
Yes. For the tangent space. D, you know, the base manifold, you know, of course I can do it even for any D because the only thing is that you have 2 to the n over 2 and you have this actually, this is true in any dimension. The only thing is that in 4 dimension you can combine actually the R squared to make conformal tensor and this is not true in if the, D is not 4. The only difference, but the answer is the coefficients are exactly the same. You know, I repeat the calculation, is nothing, you know. And you get, the only difference, you get 2 to the n over 2 because of the Clifford algebra, the gamma Clifford algebra. This is the only difference, you see? So you see, this is not completely unrelated to non-commutative geometry. There is something there. Okay, let me try to see what's further. All right, now. But I already mentioned, actually, spinners already feel everything, you know. They feel this Dirac operator. You tell, okay, I give you a new Dirac operator. It's going to feel this new Dirac operator. And, you know, it also depends on the signature. Now, if I ask you, what is the number of independent components of this spinner? The answer is known. It's 2 to the power n over 2. Because it is defined by the Clifford algebra. It's defined by the Clifford algebra times some reduction factor, R, and it's known that R is half if you have a Weyl condition or a Majorana condition, and is equal to quarter if you can in both of them simultaneously. Okay? Now you can start, actually. You say, okay, you know, I can do Young-Mills, so maybe can I do some realistic physics? And then you start scanning. You say, okay, I have only done SO groups, so the question is that, which SO would give me a good answer? And then you say, okay, maybe SO8. But, you know, then the Young-Mills is SO4. SO4 is too small. It's SU2 cross SU2, but it's too small. Then you can say, okay, maybe it is SO12. But SO12 gives me a Young-Mills with SO8. And so it is still too small. It's like supergravity. It's too small. And you really, the smallest group you really can do is SO14, essentially. And for that, the Young-Mills will be SO10. And the Young-Mills SO10 is very nice because it will have all this unification and things like that. However, what about the spinners? Now, you know, a four spinner with respect to SO13, and because this SO113, as I said, is essentially broken down to SO13 times SO10. But here, I can only impose a Weyl condition in 14 dimensions, or SO113. For SO113, you know, remember, it's exactly like, because of this mod 8 business, it's exactly like you are living in six dimensions. SO113 and SO13 difference. The difference is 8, right? Difference is 8, which is exactly my mod, you know. 6. Yeah, 6 plus 8 is 14, so it is 6. Of course, if you go to Euclidean, it's different, yeah. So here I can only impose a Weyl condition, which means that spinner would have 2 to the power 6 components. 2 to the power 6 components, it means it's really 16 plus 16 bar. And that we understand because your spinner is chiral with respect not to SO13, but to the product of the chirality of SO13 and SO10. So you really have two possibilities, you know. You can write it as a product, and of course, this can be 1 if gamma 5 is 1 and gamma is 1, or gamma 5 is minus 1 and gamma is minus 1. And that would correspond to 16 and 16 bar. So you really have here a doubling of fermions problems, you know. So you can unify, you get the perfect theory, and you really can unify it. So can one make it to work? You know, one can make it to work, you know. As I said, if you face a problem, you can always make it work. At a price, of course. And the price is that you start introducing Higgs fields like H, A, B, C, D, which gets an expectation value of epsilon A, B, C, D, and I, J, K, L. This really breaks the symmetry into SO13, SO4 cross SO6, which is the Patti-Salam group. So if you use these Higgs fields, then you can break it. And then you can give it a Majorana mass of this form, and of course with fine tuning, you can only get the left part or the right part to get mass, Majorana mass, but the left part would have no mass, and then you can do actually everything. But of course, the price you paid that you have to introduce all the Higgs fields. So this model actually can be made consistent at the price of introducing Higgs fields. So here what happened, 1 minus gamma 5 acquire Majorana mass, 1 plus gamma 5 remains massless. And then you can, you know, further break the symmetry. So in reality, you really can make this model to be realistic if you work hard enough. Now, of course, actually, you know, since here there are many practitioners of the non-commutative geometry, you say, okay, you know, you put Higgs fields. Where these Higgs fields come from? Because one advantage of non-commutative geometry is that Higgs fields belong to discrete directions, you know, gauge fields in discrete directions. So here, one has to learn to extend, actually, the Dirac operator, in such a way as to add new Higgs fields, but not adding more gauge fields, because the gauge fields are already there, okay? So that, actually, we have to learn. I have some idea how to do it, but, you know, have not worked it out in detail yet. I think it would work. How to include only Higgs fields without including the higher dimensional algebra. So just by extending the tangent space, that's all. And, you know, it could be done. So one has to introduce discrete symmetries. You know, I think, one, you know, I'm not going to spell the beans here. I know how to do it, but I don't know the physical motivation of why should I take that. But once I do that, I would recover everything that I said before, break it, and things like that. We'll see how it goes. Okay. Now, of course, actually, here everything I said was in Minkowski space, but we can you know, do it also in Euclidean space. All the proofs go through. The only thing that changes that when can you imply, when you can impose a Majorana condition or a Weyl condition. This is a very sensitive, actually. The Majorana and Weyl condition sensitive to the signature. And, of course, you know, you can say, ah, I use J psi, D psi, and things like that. But, you know, you have an ambiguity, actually, in all of this. Another ambiguity, actually, as I said in Fideli talk, that whether you are going to, you know, weak rotate the base manifold or only the tangent manifold. Here is really clear that the easiest is to rotate the tangent manifold, if you want to do. Okay. So there's some work here to be done. Now, my conclusions. So the role of the tangent grouped in gravity has been underestimated. You know, here, you know, people do gravity, they pay little attention to the tangent group. And, you know, in passing, say, ah, oh, we take a Dirac operator, we put the spin connection. Nobody asks, actually, where this spin connection came, why the tangent group must have exactly the same dimension as the manifold. Never been questioned, actually. You know, just taken. So, the metricity condition of soldering form ensures the solvability of the system and determines both the spin connection and the symmetric affine connection. So, if you insist here, we find, actually, there are two possibilities, not even one, actually. And this has been overlooked for a long time, and is really D plus 1. And here, actually, SO1D minus 1 and SO1D are identical, but spinners know the difference. Well, actually, in five dimensions, as I said, there is one other possibility which you really can take, which is SO23, okay? Now, for complex field binds, the tangent group is the unitary group. And you can take U1D minus 1 instead of SO1D minus 1. And this really gives exactly the Einstein-Strauss-Hermitian gravity. And in contrast to Einstein formulation, the formulation is extremely simple. You know, just one page and everything falls through. Now, enlarging tangent space with n larger than D and taking associated Lorentz group as the symmetry implies a generalized curvature, the soldering form admits the same metricity condition, which now only determines the d-dimensional spin connection and d-dimensional symmetric affine connection. The SO n minus d gauge connections remains arbitrary. So this is the Yang-Mills. So this actually, when I say unifying Yang-Mills and Einstein, all what you have to do, simply take SO n minus d, so increase n so that whatever group you like, you take, and you add it to the D, and you take the SON in this case, and it gives you both, you know. Nothing is really unified, actually. It's amazing that one would think that it is not, but it is. It's already there. And this Dirac operator, which this one, you know, this index already, you know, it's because in a special case it can be made zero. The difference between this Dirac operator and the usual Dirac operator is the sum of the four-dimensional Dirac operator plus Yang-Mills is identical in a special gauge. So you can promote it at no cost. The cost is going to be paid by the fermions, not the bosons. Okay? But what do you gain? You gain the Yang-Mills action. So the curvature of the n-dimensional spin connection includes both the gravity and gauge sectors. The difference is that the dynamics of gravity sector is governed by linear terms in curvature, and the gauge fits by quadratic terms. So we see actually here why the Einstein-Hilbert determines gravity, because the metricity condition is solvable for that part. For the Yang-Mills, there's no constraint whatsoever, so it keeps the Yang-Mills independent, so they are second order. Well, the gravity is governed by first order, but the omega, because the omegas are functions of the Fierbein. So it gives you, it's already second order, it gives you the dynamics. Well, actually, this also explains the relativity of the gauge fields, because they are unconstrained fields. In Yang-Mills, there are no constraint. In gravity, they are constrained. And, you know, if you look at relativity, all the complications really come because of the metricity condition. It's not really gauge theory in the normal sense. Well, actually, I would say it's the first step toward geometric unification. And in a way, it realizes Einstein's dream of unifying gravity and electromagnetism as a special case. The spinners of the unified theory of SO113 have unwanted partners which must get massive through spontaneous symmetry breaking. You know, some people did suggest actually that SO113 should break into SO31 cross SO10, in which you take the signature from here and you give it to the other one, okay? But actually, this is not a good idea because one can show that if you have a scalar field, it would feel if you have actually an odd number of Minkowski signatures, it will feel that you cheated by split by giving actually the wrong signature to SO10 and not to the Lorentz, you know. Because, you know, SO13 and SO31 are identical, but if you flip the Yang-Mills part, it, you know, the theory knows the difference and then it would catch you. Anyway, so spectral action of the new Dirac operator works, and there is no need to extend to include Higgs fields. Work has to be done, actually, in order to understand the models with Higgs fields. In, see, my tag quit at the right time. So one has to extend, actually, the model to be non-commutative in order to accommodate all these extra Higgs fields and how to break the symmetry in natural way, okay? By including the right number, the right discrete symmetry, okay? What is this discrete symmetry? Well, this has to be determined, but I think, you know, I have some ideas. Thank you. It's not the tangent. The tangent, you know, is what? Look, in non-commutative geometry, what do you do?
Gravity doesn't
see. Gravity sees. The bosonic part of gravity doesn't see. But the fermionic part, as I say, spinners is watching everything. After all, you know, that's the reason we use Dirac operator, because Dirac operator feeds geometry. It feeds. So if you give me a geometry in which you really have a larger tangent space, in which all these gauge connections part of this larger tangent space, then spinners know about it. They have larger representations. They can, you know, explain the representations of the particles as we know it now. And the bosons are not affected, as you see. Yeah? But, of course, if I include discrete symmetries, I'm going to get extra bosons like all these Dirac operators, you know, because, look, here, when I use these Higgs fields, these Higgs fields would also know. You see? Here. These are tangent space indices. So if you use bosons with tangent space indices, they will know also. You see? And of course, a vector in this higher dimensional space, in the tangent space, when you go down, it would give me a vector and a scalar. You see? So, in a way, actually, bosons still would know the difference, but bosons of the tangent space. But bosons or tensors on the curved space would not know the difference. So, it is a possibility, you know, it's a possibility. I'm not saying that this is the right answer, but it's a possibility which has been, you know, overlooked for many, many years. And, you know, I think one should take it into account. And it is rewarding, you know. It tells you, okay, what you have been writing already, when I say sum of two pieces, gravity and Yang-Mills, it's already unified. But it's in a fixed gauge, which you don't know. Okay? So I showed you what this fixed gauge. No extra modes. Did you see any? Because everything depends only on X. It doesn't depend on the higher. There's no higher dimension X. I'm not using coordinates in the tangent space. I have used, you know, I mapped, I connected a basis here and a basis there, but I didn't use, my functions are not functions of the tangent space coordinates.
There won't be like the, you know, the ground states or whatever of the compact. I mean, can you embed it?
I think it would be a hypersurface, yes, you know.
Yeah.
It would be a hypersurface, right? A very special hypersurface, yeah. Chairman would control.
Why do you call it tangent space?
Yeah.
In the sense that I was wondering what is a classical mechanics about it.
Yeah.
You may probably try to have some sort of funny constraint system.
Well, okay, I think, you know, a better name probably would be the basis of the Clifford algebra space. I don't know. Because, you know, what this space, the dimension of this space is defined by the gamma matrices of the Clifford algebra. Okay, so you start with a gamma A, some any Clifford algebra. So this is the basis, and gamma A, gamma B give me 2 eta AB. So this defines some Minkowski space in this space, which is Euclidean. And then you go from there. You know, what name? I don't know. Probably is a bad idea to give it tangent space, but in parallel.
So you don't have any more than the tangent space. So you put the tangent space inside there.
Yeah, okay. I think, you know, look, one way to do it is that, you know, I define on a manifold, I define a basis, which is E mu. Now, on this Euclidean space, I define another basis, which I call it EA. And the Fierbinds is the connecting of one base to another. So it is a larger Euclidean space with a flat basis, which is EA, which matches the dimension. Of course, like in this case, I have to say I have a coordinate, but I don't want to say I have coordinates.
Okay.
So. Yeah.
Okay, so there's a ready-made structure known in differential geometry. Mm-hmm. It's called Cartan connection.
Yes, yeah.
Classically, mm-hmm. in the Cartan connection, you have an identification mm-hmm. Of the tangent space, of the homogeneous space,
right.
with the tangent space mm-hmm. of mm-hmm. the manifold.
Right.
The manifold.
Yeah.
In your construction, you are doing something of Cartan connection,
yes, yeah.
without satisfying this Cartan condition of this, you have only a map between space and
I do. Let me go back. I show you that I do.
Different
dimensions. Yeah. Okay.
So it's a Cartan connection.
It is.
It's
a Cartan connection. No. Okay. You know, let me go back to Cartan. Here, Cartan connection. Okay. This is the torsion of a Cartan connection. Here, but. In this case, yeah, I don't say A now has the dimension 4, so let me be in 4 dimension. I say A, B, N. And in this case, you know, torsion. Now, Cartan will tell you, oh, let me take T to be 0. I'm taking, and then, you know, what I'm doing is that I'm, this actually condition would employ torsion 0. But it's a little bit, it has also metricity condition. So, it has 2, you see? So, it is Cartan formulation. In addition to a metricity condition of this E, which automatically implies that it's zero torsion Cartan connection.
No. There are 2 meanings of Cartan connection.
Yeah.
The one related to the torsion.
Right.
Which is related to the extending the structure group to this
semi-direct product, yeah.
Semi-direct product.
Right.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And this is one split.
Uh-huh.
And there's another uh-huh. meaning of Cartan connection of extending of this group to uh-huh. some bigger group of...
That's what I do. I extend it to a larger group, as you see.
Yes.
I extend it to S-O-N. So it's a larger group. So that's, you know... So it's everything is related to what Cartan did.
So the semi-direct product is one story.
Right. The only difference from Cartan that, you know, we have torsion zero, but this condition is a bit stronger than the torsion zero because, you see, it combines this and that. It combines. So because it has also a fine connection. In Cartan, you don't need to put on a fine connection to start with, you know. Okay? Nothing happens, you know, everything, okay. The only thing that happens is that your condition on the spinner. What kind? Can you impose Majorana condition or wire condition? Or, you know, it's the only thing that's going to happen. What kind of conditions you can impose on the spinners? The only thing. Well, in this way I did it, I only get SO and minus D. In this, if I start in four dimension, SO and minus 4. For arbitrary N. SO and minus 4 for arbitrary N. You get any group you like. You see? So you can get, you know, SO 18 minus 4, so it's SO 14, in which you can impose both Weyl and Majorana condition. It doesn't help you much. It gives you the same kind of symmetry, actually, that you have here.
Okay, so in a moment we're going to have an announcement, but let's just wrap up Ali's talk and thank you again.
Thank you.